What do you believe could have happened here?
Well, I don't want to be glib. You know, the train didn't stop. The train engineer is the man in charge of controlling the train. And so the question comes down to, why didn't he? Did he have a medical episode? Somehow he became incapacitated. You know, recall the derailment in 2013 up at Spuyten Duyvil, where the engineer was zoned out. Or the Philadelphia accident of 2015, where the engineer was busy talking to on the radio because another train was being hit by stones, and he forgot where he was and speeded up. So that's what, you know, the NTSB, they're on their way. That's what they'll start looking at. You know, I don't know if I haven't heard. If you know if the engineer survived.
Yeah, that we don't know yet. We're not sure. We can't confirm exactly who did perish during the crash this morning. I know some people, the witness accounts that we've been speaking with this morning have said the train simply didn't stop at all. There are some that, you know, talk about the, you know, kind of like that we were talking before about the bumper that's at the end of the tracks. I mean, that's really not there to stop a train if it's not braking. It's more or less just an impediment that's going to only get in the way and cause more damage. So there's really, you know, we really can't speculate as to what happened here, whether it's with the conductor or with the train itself.
Exactly. But that's the first line, you might say the first line of defense is the guy who's in charge of the train, who's controlling the train. Why didn't he do it? And until you know that, it starts, you know, becoming a little harder to say what could have been done to prevent it. I know I mentioned to somebody, you know, you hear about, you know, some 18-year-old basketball player on the court dies of some previously undiagnosed heart condition. You know, could something like that have happened to this engineer? So I don't know how you prevent against that, but there are signal system backups.
And that's what I wanted to ask you, Gus.
Could prevent that.
Yeah, Gus, can we talk about mechanically what could have gone wrong here?
Well, see, that's the other thing, too. Mechanically, you know, you see in TV shows and, you know, Hollywood movies, you know, the brakes failed and the train is careening down the hill out of control because you can't apply the brakes. But train brakes don't work that way. You know, you cut the line on your car, the fluid runs out, the brakes don't work. Well, the fluid for trains is air. And if you cut the line and let the fluid leak out, it sets the brakes.
Gus, let me ask you this. NTSB shows up. Whether the conductor, you know, is able to answer the pertinent questions that they've got to ask or not. What is their next course of action? Is it go right for the black box? I mean, what are the inspectors going to look for right away to be able to ascertain exactly what happened here?
They're going to start with they're going to recover the black box. They'll take that off site and they'll download the stuff. And then they'll start with where the train stopped and work their way back. They'll take apart the train itself. They'll determine, you know, how the black box will determine how fast it was going. The condition of the train will determine, you know, what it hit. For all we know, this train could have derailed as it was coming into the station. And so if the wheels are no longer on the rails, you apply the brakes, it's not going to stop the train because now the train is out of control. I mean, those are all possibilities, and that's why anytime you have an incident like this, people are saying, well, the train never seemed to slow down. So don't just jump to that as a conclusion. You work your way back. And, you know, that's a piece of information. You keep that in your back pocket. You then look at all the factors, everything that may have contributed to this, so that speed may have been a factor, but there are a lot of reasons why maybe it wouldn't have mattered.
Gus, we've been talking about safety systems that need to be put in place to prevent accidents like this from happening.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, would something like this have been able to prevent this accident?
There are signal systems out there that you can issue commands to the train to say, as you approach this location, you can't be going more than 25 miles an hour or more than 15 miles an hour. And if the engineer does not acknowledge that signal and take action in a particular amount of time, the train will do it for him. Now, positive train control is one of those systems. There are systems that have been around for 50 years that do that. But it requires you to put some sort of transmitter in the track that sends the coded signal to the train. And as I've pointed out to a number of people, when was the last time a train ran off the track here at Hoboken?
Yeah, so, you know, a number of the people that we've spoken with this morning and some other, you know, people that I know that commute on this line or various lines through Hoboken always say that, you know, the train always kind of crawls as it comes into the station, whether it would be on track 5 or the other tracks. And then to hear some of the passengers that we've spoken to this morning that said the train just came barreling through. It simply just did not stop. You're an expert. So what would be the first thing that would come to your mind when you hear something like that?
That if the train's supposed to be coming in, then it's the engineer. Why didn't the engineer do it? And again, if all the people you talk to say the train is always crawling when it comes into this station, then with the limited dollars that are available to do a lot of other things that are maybe more, you know, very safety related to transportation of their passengers, would I put a signal system in that's going to slow the train down to 15 when my trains are always crawling? And, you know, the Hoboken terminal here has been around for 100 years, going back to the Lackawanna.
Yeah.
You know, so it's never happened. So do I spend my money here, or do I spend it on something that might get me more of a return on safety in other areas?
But don't we say this all the time? It never happens here, Gus. And then we come on and we report breaking news, and then we ask the same question: should a safety system have been put in place?
You can always second guess yourself. And, you know, nothing in terms of safety, nothing, very few things are absolute. And so in a situation like the curve at Philadelphia, you have trains going over there all the time, and it's a simple thing to simply say 50 miles an hour, put in a coded circuit. In something like this, there are other, again, without knowing the system, I have to say, I don't know what kind of system they have there, what kind of signals they have in approach to this that slow him down. It's, you know, the key is, the engineer has control of the train. Why didn't he have control of the train? What signal systems were in place beforehand, you know, to slow him down? And yes, a cab signaling system, like I said, has been around for 50 years, would have been slowing him down. Would there have been something right at the platform to say that, okay, you have to be going zero now? Those, yes, could help. And if you've got a cab signaling system built into the trains, it's a simple matter to add it to here. Should that have been done? Again, hindsight, you can always say it should have been.
Yeah.
Well, it's something they'll certainly be talking about, I'm sure, as we wait for news conferences. We understand the officials are on the scene who are investigating. Gus Ubaldi, railroad engineering expert, we appreciate your time. Thank you very much for your insight into this.
Yeah, very insightful. Thank you, Gus. We appreciate it.